Secretary Tom Vilsack joining us here to discuss some of the progress that's been made over the past year, Mr. Secretary, including, you know, the White House has had several initiatives. We call the White House Competition Council. That includes a group of programs to help with the supply chain issues here in agriculture. How is that going? It sounds like we're making some progress on that front.
Some progress for sure. Focus first and foremost on processing, making sure that we expand the capacity of existing processing facilities and then building new processing facilities. On the expansion side, we've already provided grants to 167 facilities across the United States to allow them to basically go across state lines to be able to sell products that expands market. We've helped several thousand very small lockers and small facilities with reduced inspection fees. We've just recently guaranteed almost $250 million in loans for mid-level supply chain operations, warehousing, cold storage, as part of our effort at loan guarantees. And we have $150 million of grant resources available. We received over 300 applications to build new processing capacity. So we'll be making decisions on that in the very near future. And then we'll provide another $225 million of grants in that area over the course of the next several months. So we've made a lot of progress, a lot more to do, a lot of decisions to be made, but are really pleased with that aspect of the competition effort. And we've expanded it, frankly. The president wanted us to focus not just on processing, but also on fertilizer and some of the input challenges that we face. And so we have a couple more days left in the request for information stage of how we would best use $500 million of expanded fertilizer opportunities. So a lot going on in this space.
Yeah, if we break that down just a little bit and we talk about the importance of making some changes, you know, the pandemic, it really shed a lot of different lights on what was happening in the food supply chain. Do you feel like this will move the needle, that this was needed, something that will really kind of shore up that part of our market?
Well, I tell you, it was needed before the before COVID, but we may not have been fully appreciative or aware of how much resilience we needed to put back into our food supply system. We certainly have received concerns, obviously, from the cattle industry, the hog industry over and poultry industry over a long period of time about the lack of capacity. So we are trying to respond to that. But I think as we went deeper into it, we realized that there are a lot of aspects of that food supply chain that need to be shored up. It's not just meat and poultry processing. We also announced $600 million of resources on the non-meat and poultry processing side. That, too, is going to be rolled out in the very near future. So we're going to continue to look for ways to strengthen, to create, if you will, that local and regional food system that will complement the more commercial-sized operations that we have, that really provides greater strength, greater competition, greater capacity, greater choice for consumers. And we think over time, better incomes for farmers and better deals for consumers at the grocery store.
Secretary, does this remain an important project, even as we, and I want to say this, normalize everyday life here, kind of, you know, as we start to kind of sort out what's happening with this pandemic?
Well, you know, the COVID may have other ideas about all of this because we continue to get different variants. But I think the underlying answer to your question is that regardless of the status of COVID, we've got to strengthen our food supply system. It's not just COVID. There are two other C's, if you will. There's conflict, the invasion by Russia, unprovoked invasion by Russia, has caused some challenges and concerns with reference to the supply chain that we need to respond to, and the fertilizer initiative is an example. It's also climate change. And the reality is that over time, we're going to have to make sure that we're in a position to respond to natural disasters that make it more difficult in a particular area of the country to be able to produce what we need. So it's a combination of all those, COVID, conflict, climate change, that requires us to invest in a stronger and transformed food system.
Secretary, you mentioned the fertilizer and kind of increasing some of that here, especially domestically. How is that going? Do we know yet how we do that? And
we,
do it in a timely fashion?
Yeah. Well, we don't know for sure. And that's why we went out and requested information from those who do know. That deadline is July 15th, so it's coming up in the next couple of days. Once we get those comments in, we'll basically analyze those comments and then structure the program based on the response and reaction that we got from folks who know. We did this very similar with the Climate Smart Commodity Initiative, and we saw overwhelming response to that. So I would expect and anticipate we'll see something similar. Now, while we're waiting for that to come to fruition, we'll also be working with NRCS to provide more technical assistance, more information, and more support for producers so that they can be more precise in the utilization of inputs like fertilizer, so that they can potentially try to save a little bit at the present time while we begin to shore up our own capacity here in the U.S. to produce fertilizer.
One of the other things that we've talked quite a bit about is both rail and making sure that our ports are serving our agricultural producers. How is that process and those conversations going to make sure that, you know, we are able to get products where they need to go once they are ready?
Well, we've invested at USDA in a variety of programs in a number of ports to try to reduce the congestion and to encourage, obviously, more expedited delivery of our exported goods to other markets and more imports coming into the United States so that we're in a position to have a more resilient system. We've invested in Oakland, Seattle, Tacoma, Houston, and Savannah, and we expect and anticipate looking at Baltimore as well. So that, I think that part of our effort has been, successful to date. We've also worked very closely with both labor and the port operators and ownership to encourage that there's not a work stoppage. As contracts are being negotiated, in the past, there was always the threat that there would be a work stoppage that would create a bit of havoc for American agriculture, since so much is exported through the West Coast ports. We've received assurances from both labor and management that they don't expect and anticipate a work stoppage. You know, we continue to work with rail. I think there's still work to be done there. We've obviously expressed concerns to the Surface Transportation Board. Having said that, I think there is now a recognition on the part of many of the major rail companies that they need to invest more, both in equipment and personnel, and they need to have perhaps greater transparency, more predictability, if you will, with schedules. Sometimes they can't, sometimes something happens, Mother Nature floods out a terminal or things of that nature that they don't have control over, which obviously disrupts things. But I think there is a bit more investment that can be done on that side.
Mr. Secretary, if you have time, I'd like to ask you a couple other questions. Just, one, talking about the House recently passed the Lower Food and Fuels Cost Act to include a special USDA investigator. Do you feel like that is a good idea? Is it the right approach? Is that something that would fit at USDA?
Well, I think people are obviously anxious to make sure that markets are fair. At the end of the day, I think we all want that. And to the extent that there is the need to ask questions, the need to have enforcement of packers and stockyards, we think that there are several ways to do that. One way is by supporting the notion of having an investigative arm, if you will. The other way is to bolster the staffing at packers and stockyards, which the president's budget includes. So a combination of those two things would strengthen our ability. In the meantime, we're going to try to strengthen the Packers and Stockyards Act to make sure that when and if we have to enforce it, that there's clarity about what is and what isn't appropriate and permissible under the Packers and Stockyards. Greater transparency, greater appreciation for more cash sale information and data so that we feel comfortable that the market is what it needs to be competitive and fair, and more competition, obviously. The combination of all those factors, I think, will ensure that producers are getting a fair shake.
Kind of tag along with that, you know, we had the Cattle Market Price Discovery and Transparency Act also, I think, came out of the Senate. Is that the right approach? Does that maybe follow along with some of the things you were just saying?
Well, it is, and I think we will be prepared at USDA when and if Congress passes the bill and President signs it to enforce it. Now, I don't want to suggest that this is going to be a simple process. It's not. Obviously, markets are very complex. Data points are incredibly important. Regions change and are different from place to place. Markets are different from place to place. But having said that, if we're charged with the responsibility of creating greater transparency and more information and data so that people can make more informed decisions, we'll do our level best to make sure that we comply with congressional intent.
One of the other questions I had for you, and obviously we've been following along the situation with Ukraine. Are there any updates from that part of the world, what it means for global food supplies, and what U.S. farmers can do here at home and how they may be impacted?
Well, I'd say a couple of things. There are ongoing negotiations between the Turkish leadership, the UN, Ukrainian leadership, and Russia. to determine whether or not the ports can be reopened, whether the mines can be removed, and whether there can be safe passage for ships that would export needed grain to North Africa and the Middle East. While those conversations are ongoing, we continue to look for ways in which we can help the Ukrainians basically move as much product as possible out of their country, so as they begin the harvest of this year's crop, that they have storage capacity. I think we've been very forceful in our language in encouraging Russia to stop doing what they have done, which is to destroy grain, to steal grain, to destroy storage facilities. That's just not appropriate. Food should not be a weapon of war, in our view. Back home here, it's really about trying to help producers be able to make the best set of decisions they can while increasing for that purpose, we have essentially made a CRP land that's coming out of the program more readily available and more earlier available for the pre-planning decision making and actions on the part of producers. And we've also recently just announced a series of amendments to maps in terms of double cropping and crop insurance protection and availability, roughly 1,500 counties added to the previous list of counties. So we're doing what we can to give producers as many tools as possible so that they can make the most informed decision for themselves, and at the same time, hopefully see greater production, which allows us to export more. We've also triggered our humanitarian relief effort through the Bill Emerson Trust, and working with USAID to get those resources and those grains to the appropriate markets as quickly as possible.
Are you hopeful that the safe passage of grain gets worked out between
Ukraine
and all parties?
Well, always hopeful. Always hopeful, but remain skeptical of the good faith that Russia brings to the table. They should never have invaded Ukraine. They should stop this war immediately. They should stop doing what they're doing in terms of making food a weapon of war. They should stop the propaganda and try to misdirect the rest of the world in terms of who's causing any shortages that may be experienced in North Africa and the Middle East. So we have to be very strong and very consistent in our messaging on that score. But we are taking steps to try to help the Ukrainians as best we can under the circumstances. And we've pledged to be there, frankly, when this war ends. They're going to have to rebuild their agricultural economy. We want to be helpful because it's an important partner with the U.S. and other countries that are trying to make sure that we have global food security.
Mr. Secretary, last question. One quick last question. We've talked quite a bit here lately about maybe possibly lifting or removing some of the Chinese tariffs. Are there any that would be helpful for agriculture or U.S. agriculture specifically?
Well, clearly there are tariffs that have been assessed, but the Chinese have been flexible in terms of the assessment of those tariffs, which has allowed us to resume a fairly robust amount of trade with China. Having said that, I think frankly, I've said this before and I'll say it again, I think it's important for U.S. agriculture to be less dependent and reliant on that Chinese market. For that reason, we're going to continue to look for ways to reduce barriers in Southeast Asia. We were excited about the visit of President López Obrador from Mexico and the agreement signed yesterday by President Biden and President López Obrador that essentially indicates the willingness of Mexico not only to purchase additional dairy products from the U.S., but also additional feed grain, which I think is an important signal coming from Mexico that they continue to be a valued customer, if you will, for the yellow corn that's produced in this country. So a lot of opportunities here. We're looking at a record year in exports. We want to make sure we continue to build on that. Reducing tariffs in China is one strategy, but by no means is the only strategy, nor should it be.
A record year of exports. Always good to end on some positive news. Thank you so much, Mr. Secretary. Sure appreciate you joining us today.
You bet. Thank you.
Thank you.